And the other project, big project area, is working with Leeds City Council on infrastructure. And you know, one of the first projects they've been working on is road repairs. So instead of waiting for holes in the road to appear, what you do is you fly a drone over the road system, or you run a you put cameras on the back of refuse trucks, and you detect cracks in the road, and then you fly a drone in to that point. It lands on the crack and sprays some kind of resin into the crack to stop the crack from developing into a massive hole. So here's the thing landing on the crack. No, she didn't actually see it landing. It's because it was a pretty windy day, I think. Actually, it's pretty difficult to land a drone on a small patch, but it then sprays this resin in and takes off again and moves on to the next crack in the road. So the whole idea of robotics and AI supporting city infrastructure is an area of huge potential. And I'll just finish by just noting another big area for the university, which is AI and health, another exploding area. And of course the regional or the city has a huge role to play in that as well. I know that's outside the scope, I'm guessing it's outside the scope of the catapult, for example. But maybe, I'd like to be proved, maybe I'm wrong there. But you know, it's obviously got a big sort of city
element. I think we try not to rule things like that outside, because just we're anyway supposed to work with other counterparts and with other institutions. So you know, as long as we're doing a bit that we're actually good at, the fact that it's mainly on something else.
So it'd be great to find for us. It'd be great to find connections between the infrastructure work and the health work that we're doing, you know, just to bind those two things together. Huge potential in that. Environmental pollution, particulate content, and you know, and the design of the road system, and medical records. And, great. Okay. Well, that's me. I hope that was just me being indulgent, but I hope at least it was interesting as well. Okay.
Thanks very much.
Command F.
Oh, thank you. No, that's fine. It's fine. I'll just leave it. It's fine. Thank you very much for inviting me. It's a pleasure to talk about some of the research that we're doing here in Leeds and the Alan Turing Urban Analytics Program. I was told I could talk for 10 minutes, but I'm sorry, I'm going to go over to about 12. The reason being is that the program is great, but it's quite boring just to introduce a program. So I'm going to start with a couple of examples of the research that we're actually doing, because I think that's a bit more interesting than just telling you about kind of what we're aiming to achieve. So just about me, I'm a professor of spatial science. So I have a computer science undergraduate degree, and then moved into geography to do my PhD. So I've got kind of computer science skills and applying them to problems that geographers are interested in, so spatial problems, which you'll see in a minute. And working with the Alan Turing Institute is great, because it brings together people from all sorts of different disciplines, particularly on the harder sciences, which we really need to help with some of these technical and computational challenges. Okay, so in terms of what we're actually doing, I'm going to talk about this middle box here. So as part of the Urban Analytics Program, we are looking at how you can understand what's happening in cities using big data. I won't talk about that at all. That's work that my colleague Alison Heppenstall and others are working on. We're moving towards trying to create digital twins, which I'll come on to a bit at the end, but I'll spend most of my time talking about this middle box here, which is building simulations of cities in real time and trying to feed data into them while they're running, which is something that we can't do at the moment. And why do we want to do that? Well, if you think about somewhere like Trafalgar Square, we've got very good data on the people who live here. So we have the census, which is great. There are other surveys, council tax records, these kinds of things. So we have lots of information about the residents of areas like Millennium Square, like Trafalgar Square, etc. What we don't know about the people who visit there. So why people go to these areas, what they do when they're there, where they go afterwards. We have much less data about these ambient populations. And these are really important because if you look at things like how serious crime problems are, they could be, it could be an endemic crime problem, or it could just be something that happens when you have large groups of people. But if you don't know about the number of people in an area, you can't calculate crime rates accurately. If we want to look at pollution, who's being exposed, how serious a problem is high pollution, again, we need to know who's actually in the area to be exposed. If we understand the movements of people, we can look at the economy and how we can get them to spend longer in city centres, which is something the councils are really keen on doing, obviously, because they spend money when they're in city centres. And if we want to encourage more active travel, again, we need to know about how people are moving around, where they're spending their time, where they might be able to make journeys more sustainably and healthily. So there's loads of good reasons to understand the ambient population as well as the residential population. And the way that we're trying to do that as part of the Urban Analytics Programme is through simulation. So what we'd like to do is build agent-based models, and these are simulations that take individual things, so these could be people or cars or businesses, stakeholders, put them into a model, let them interact in a virtual environment, and then basically see what comes out. So that's a computer game, my models don't look nearly that good, but that gives you the idea. So you can have individual units making decisions, trying to achieve goals, doing things, interacting. So they're agent-based models. They can predict the near future well, so if we feed them lots of really good, accurate data, they can make relatively good short-term predictions, but those predictions will inevitably start to fall down over time. If we leave these models running for anything, minutes, hours, days, the simulation is going to diverge from reality, because people are always making decisions that we can never predict 100% accurately, or even particularly accurately. So we need a way to feed these models with real-time data to keep them in line with what's actually happening in the real world. And what we're trying to do is use a technique called data assimilation. This is a mathematical technique that organisations like Met Office use when they do weather forecasting, and it's a way of taking observations from the real world. So in this case, it could be data from traffic counters, it could be footfall counters, it could be social media contributions, basically anything that might tell you about the dynamics in a city, feed it into the agent-based model, and then it could stay more up to date with the real world. This is what that might look like. So if you imagine our model making some sort of hypothetical estimate of what the state of the world is like now, if we get some data, we can feed it into the model can adjust its state so that it's more like the real world, and then any predictions that you make from that point will be that much better because you've got up-to-date data in the model. Okay, so that's what we're trying to do. Before I talk about the programme, I'll just give you two examples of experiments that are running at the moment. No one has developed these kinds of methods for agent-based models yet, so we're starting small with some quite relatively simple systems. The first example is a hypothetical train station. So starting with something like this, if you imagine a train arriving, some people getting off at one side, they need to get across the concourse and exit through the other side. And depending on the speed that people walk and kind of decisions that they make about how to navigate the station, you're going to get crowding at various points. And this is quite difficult to predict beforehand because we don't know particularly well how people are going to behave. So what we're trying to do is feed in data from a situation like this and then keep this simulation more in line with what's actually happening in reality. And okay, so this is what the model looks like. There are a few hundred synthetic agents and they all try and move across the platform. The way that we're trying to feed data into that at the moment is using something called a particle filter. So what this does is it runs thousands or even millions of separate simulations, and then when you get some data, you look at which of your simulations are working well, which are working badly, and you chuck out the ones that are working badly and keep the ones that are working well, basically. So this image shows where two of those synthetic people are. There are hundreds of them on there, but I'm only showing two. And these little red dots show where all of those different models are predicting those two agents are. So right from the beginning, some models are predicting this agent is all the way out here, others are predicting it's kind of around there, which is more accurate. And as you'll see, what will happen is as these simulations move, as they run forward through time, the locations that they predict are going to start to diverge, because in some models there'll be some crowding happening at different places, so these agents will start to be in the wrong place. But then as you can feed it in some more data about the situation, they'll come down again. So they diverge, they're getting worse. When it gets smaller again, you just keep the particles that are good, throw away the bad ones, and then you've got a much more accurate representation of what's actually happening. And that's just with two. So this is a kind of simulation that, or the kind of approach that we're trying to feed our simulations with data. One of the drawbacks with this kind of approach is that you need large numbers of particles for doing anything that's reasonably complicated. So in a station, you might need thousands or millions of particles. In a city, it's getting into very large numbers. So that's a problem we're tackling. And then just as an aside, you can also use this kind of technique possibly more successfully to predict something like the movements of buses. So this shows a bus travelling on a bus route. On the horizontal axis is the time that it started, and on the vertical axis is the distance away from its depot. And what you could do is start to, if you know where the buses are, because they all have GPS trackers on them, so you can feed that location into your model. You can then make more accurate short-term predictions than you would have done if you didn't have the model, because we can start to estimate things that you don't know from the available data. So we don't know how many people are waiting at downstream stops, we don't know what the traffic conditions are like, we don't even know how many people are on the bus. So if we have a model predicting all of these things, the models that are working well, their buses will be located near the GPS data because they've got accurate estimates of where people are. The ones that are doing badly won't have, so they're abandoned. So if we can feed this kind of thing into our bus models, then we can make more reliable forecasts about where buses are and where they're going to be in the next 5, 10 minutes, half an hour, etc. So that's all pretty exciting. So imagine scaling that up to models of a city. That's where we're trying to get to. One of the things I think we hopefully will touch on in the discussion are some of the ethical implications. So I won't spend too much time on them here. We know that the data are biased. There are lots of kind of inherent biases in society, and we need to be very careful about designing algorithms that aren't just going to perpetuate those biases. We also need to be very careful about the digital divide, so people who either don't engage with digital services because they can't or they don't want to, they can't be excluded from policy. So that's something particularly with smart cities we need to be very aware of. And just in terms of tracking people, one of the is quite an ethical way of trying to do that. I mentioned that. Okay, but where we're trying to get to is a digital twin of an area. So starting small, maybe a train station, and then growing up into cities and larger areas across the country. Digital twins are really common in engineering, so they can build digital representations of actual physical infrastructure, and then you can start to test interventions on these virtual infrastructures without having to actually go and damage bridges and things. So what we'd like to do is start to create something like this for cities and for other areas. Okay, and in the last couple of minutes, I would just like to introduce the Alan Turing Institute and the Urban Analytics Program, which is running out of Leeds. So the Alan Turing Institute is the National, I always get this wrong, Institute for Data Science and Artificial Intelligence. And it was set up a few years ago. It's a network of industry, charities and government partners linked with a number of universities. I can't remember how many. I'll come on to that in a sec. 8 or 10, I think. And it's a target for strategic government investment. So it's linked to lots of the government's programmes. The goals are to innovate and develop world-class research, hence the collaborations with universities. It's tackling real-world problems. It's training the next generation of researchers and leaders, they call it. So this is things like funding PhD places and funding other training opportunities. And it aims to advise policymakers and the public. It has 8 aims, and these are to use artificial intelligence to revolutionise healthcare, deliver safer, smarter engineering, manage security in an insecure world, shine light on the economy. And there are other 4 are make algorithmic systems more fair and transparent, design computers for the next generation of algorithms, supercharge research in science and humanities, and then foster government intervention. And obviously I haven't got time to go into detail any of those, but the website is fantastic. So if you do want to find out any more about their challenges or their programmes, it is actually a very good website, very easy to navigate. This is what the university network looks like. It started off with 4 or 5 partners and then expanded recently, and Leeds is one of the partners. And our role in the Turing is to organise the Urban Analytics Programme. So this is focused on developing AI and data science methods to look at the process, structure, interactions of things in cities. So agents, individuals, technologies and infrastructure. The basis for this programme is that cities are currently housing the majority of the world's population, that's set to grow. They can drive wealth creation, social interaction and well-being, but there are big issues in cities such as inequality in health, affluence, education and lifestyle. We all know this. So the programme is aiming to develop methods that can try and tackle some of those problems. Okay, so the last couple of slides. For any more information about what we're doing, these are some links to the research that I mentioned before. I won't go into Brexit, a lot of it's funded by the EU, but we'll leave that there. If you want more information about the Urban Analytics Programme in particular, the director is Mark Birkin, who couldn't be here today because he's travelling, or you can get in contact with Will Taylor, who is the project manager, or me as well. And very final slide, if anyone wants to do some research for the next 3 years, we're recruiting a research fellow, which will be a really exciting job, loads of cool modelling stuff, so pass that on, please. Okay, thank you.
As it goes on, will there be opportunities for businesses and say the local public sector to partner with programs with the Urban Growth Programme?
Yeah, absolutely. So Nexus is great because we can always meet here. But I would just suggest anyone who's interested in this to contact me or anyone else involved with the programme. We all want to show impact. So if we can work with businesses and policymakers and the public, then that's an easy route for us to have our research actually used and be useful rather than just sitting on my desk being fun but not going anywhere.
Yeah.
So I'd really encourage people to get in touch with us.
I think we also have responsibilities in that direction.
Absolutely.
Well.
Yeah.
Commercialisation of research. Thank you.
Any other questions?
Just on that point, maybe Ben, the question of pathways to impact, just of all the opportunities that are out there for an academic to get involved with policy, industry, when they're very busy, how do you encourage them to gain that confidence from your own experience?
That's a hard question. I haven't found it that hard to encourage people. I mean, because I think people don't tend to get into academia because they want to hide away and just think about problems. They're genuinely interested in trying to solve real problems, and the only way you can do that is by working with people outside of academia. Yes, we're all busy, but it's, you know, a big part of actually making the job worthwhile.
So the building networks is important. The balance between conference, publication, drivers, and the need to sit down with businesses and talk about what their requirements are. Bit of balance is what's required?
For reasons other than it being the right thing to do, if you want research funding, impact is now very often quite a high criteria to receive research funding. So if you haven't had those conversations beforehand, it's very difficult to show that what you're proposing would actually be useful when it needs to be. So there's benefits for academics who are actually engaging as well.
Thank you.
Oh, shall I leave that?
There is an event coming up in July, a big sort of AI in the North event, I don't know if you're aware of that, but I thought I'd plug it. I've nothing to do with it actually, but I only came across it this week. But it's sponsored by the City Council and others, and I think it's the 17th of July, it might be on more than one day. But that's another opportunity for the university and
specific examples of things you are trying to fix in Leeds?
No, the short answer is no, because so we set up a project 3 years ago, which was to build a big simulation and then apply it to looking at exposure to pollution and crime levels. And a very small part of that project was to just feed the model with some data. It turns out that's incredibly difficult, so we've now received funding for a 5-year project from the EU just to do that little bit. And we're about 2 years into that project and we're still developing the methods. So I'm hoping in a year, maybe less than a year, we'll actually have a model with a method that works and can feed data in real time, and then we can actually start to look at problems. It's not satisfactory, but it's very hard and it's not been done before. And we need to get the methods right, otherwise the simulations will be useless.
So is pollution and crime a thing? Why have you chosen that?
Oh, okay, so my PhD was in crime analysis, so it's an area that I'm quite familiar with, so it's a sort of personal choice. Pollution, because it's such a massive health problem. And it's something that I think these kinds of methods are reasonably kind of well attuned to solving. So there are things that you wouldn't do with an agent-based model that it wouldn't help solving, but I think looking at how cities work and how people move around them is something it's very good at, and that will obviously have huge impacts on pollution.
Are they very good at it?
What's it?
Agent-based models? I've got a big problem with agent-based models being applied in this context when we've got enough data to use quite simple models to do this. So,
okay.
I think the question is still open about whether or not we should be using agent-based models in this context.
No. The reason I think we need to use them is because we haven't got the data.
Yeah.
I mean, we don't know how many people are in city centres. We don't know who's being exposed. So the model there is filling in the gaps. We have some football counters in Leeds, so we have a very broad picture about where people are at 7 different locations, I think, which is great, and that's exactly the kind of data that needs to feed our model. But it's not enough for us to build up a reasonable picture of what urban flows actually look like. So the idea of the model is it can fill in those gaps.
Yeah.
The data is left. I mean, it's a bit like meteorology, right? You wouldn't predict the weather based on scattered temperature and pressure data.
No.
You'd need a model to fill in where you haven't got data and make predictions about the future. So that's why I think something like agent-based modelling has value.
So my challenge will be that I don't think you try hard enough to collect the data. And you need to do that first, and then do the model.
Should we save this for the panel?
Yeah,
that sounds like a good thing to discuss.
Yeah.
I kind of agree with Nick a little bit, but there is a way of...
Let's just save it for the panel thing. Yeah.
Okay.
So you can also interpolate data as well using neural networks. There's lots of other ways in which you can do it using value inference techniques. And so I'd like to talk to David about that.
Great. I just wondered if the temptation to incorporate identifiable data will actually become too great and people will start to do that in the community.
It's a really good point.
Think of face recognition technology.
Yeah, no, absolutely.
Criminology works, for example.
So I don't think for these kinds of models that individual traces will help, because there's nothing to say that the behaviour of a person on a day is characteristic of how they would normally behave or that it would help. So it's a difficult balance, isn't it? Someone could always behave unethically with your work, and I don't know how you protect against that, but I think in this case, individual tracking wouldn't benefit the overall digital twin that we're making, which would be a good reason not to do it, if that makes sense.
Great, well, thanks very much. We move on to the panel. I'm actually about to start some work on geospatial ethics for audience survey on very much those points about if you need to track actual people through a city, then you're tracking actual people and you get a whole load of privacy and issues that you don't have a whole load of other things. Cool. James. Come on, James.
Would you like to introduce yourself?
So
tell us a bit also about what you're working on in this space.
So my name is Tamar Loach. I am data science team lead at the Vector Places Catapult, which on CERD is a combination.